Okay, welcome. I'm really happy to see all of you here. This is something of an experiment, both mathematically and socially. Mathematically, we're going to try to introduce algebraic topology, in part following the historical development. There was a fantastic period of mathematics in the 1950s, early 1960s. Stopped just before I started. Where all the basic directions that we now follow were first established. This is also something of a social experiment. There are something like 50 of you who are just here for the week. This is also the sixth week of an eight-week REU. And so people from the REU, maybe raise your hands who have been going to the topology. Okay, there are a bunch of people who have been going to topology courses for the last 4 or 5 weeks. And of course, they were lost too. But they should be a resource because they will probably know at this point more than most of you and will be happy to answer questions. Okay. So we are in part following a historical survey I wrote for stable algebraic topology between 1945 and 1966. Seemed a reasonable stopping point. We'll try to explain the mathematics in more modern terms, but also follow the historical development, which is very interesting and not at all what one would think it might have been. So I'm going to start way back in the 1930s with the very beginning of the subject. Before that, people never used groups. They used numbers called the Betty numbers so that they look at the dimension of a rational vector space and compute it from topological data, and that would be called a Betty number for a mathematician named Betty. It was Emmy Noether who first gave the idea that everything should be done in terms of groups, not just numbers. And the story is that that happened at a dinner at Brouwer's house in 1925. And was not really written down, just people caught on to it very quickly and started using groups from then on. So you're going to see, not in my talk, but later talks, chain complexes with cycles modulo boundaries. That language only developed in the mid-1920s, late 1920s. Cohomology and something like a modern understanding of Poincaré duality came a few years later. I think Agnes will talk about that. How many people do not know what a homotopy between maps is? Raise your hands. What?
Don't be shy.
Yeah, right. I have it in my notes. Don't be shy. By the way, I have complete notes, so if you don't worry about taking notes. They will be online by tonight or something. We'll get them up. They're kind of slapdash because I just did it yesterday, but you know, they're there. Okay, so we know what a homotopy is. Hopf proved that the Hopf map, S3 into S2, is not null homotopic in 1930, and that was something of a surprise. We'll come later to explaining what that map is and how to see that it's not null homotopic a little further on. Zakharevich introduced homotopy groups in 1935. Actually, Czech had introduced them 3 years earlier, but he was told not to publish it for two reasons. One, the groups were the higher homotopy groups were all abelian, so probably not very interesting. And also, he could give no method for computing the homotopy groups, and nor can we. So before World War II, pi 4 of S3, I'll say what that is in a moment, was Z mod 2. Around 1945, it was 0. And that's the sub-story of the computation of homotopy groups from then on. Their literature is riddled with mistakes later corrected. It's just really, really hard. However, homotopy groups are very, very easy to define. So let's define them. here we're going to look at. I'm sorry?
If it was
zero
before World War II, what is it now?
Oh, it's C-mod 2. Maybe 20 years later, there was an editorial in the New York Times. There are two published papers. One said a certain element was zero. The other said a certain element was not zero. And the editorial in the New York Times asked whether this was the contradiction in mathematics. I'll give another instance Thursday when I talk about Bott periodicity, where that contradicted a published calculation. I mean, it is truly the history of the subject to find mistakes and correct them gradually. However, the definition is utterly straightforward. We're going to consider spaces X with a chosen base point. Okay? Take the n-sphere and give it a chosen base point. Look at continuous maps from Sn into X, which take the base point of Sn to the base point of X. Okay? Take homotopy classes of those maps, where homotopies are required to be based. That is, at every time t between 0 and 1, the base point gets mapped to the base point. That's a based homotopy. And then pi n x, you write it as pi n x star if you're silly enough to want to change your base point, is the set of based homotopy classes of based maps from the n-sphere to x. That's all it is. It takes 2 seconds to define. This is a set, if n equals 0, a set with a base point. The base point given by pi naught is actually the set of components of x, because s naught is 2 points, one of which goes to the base point, and the other picks out a component, path component. Spaces are path connected if they're connected today. So pi naught x is the set of components. Pi 1 x is the fundamental group. I'm hoping everybody knows what the fundamental group is. Everybody happy with that? Okay. If not, there it is. It's a group because a map on the circle is just a loop, and you can compose loops by going around one and going around the other, each at half speed. Okay? And pi 2 of x and so on up, these all turn out to be abelian groups, as Check had noticed. Okay. I'm not going to prove that. I should say, detailed proofs of everything I'm saying this hour are in my book, A Concise Course in Algebraic Topology, and everybody is welcome to read it. It's online, number 95 on my webpage. So everything, you can find out details. Okay. Right. So I said that Zakharevich first wrote down the definition of homotopy groups in 1935. There's an absolutely amazing theorem published already in 1937 called the Freudenthal suspension theorem. And to this day, it is, it's one of the really truly illuminating great results, and it's one of the ones that we will be talking about that was completely unexpected. There's just no idea that something like that should be true. It's an incredible result. So say that X is N connected if pi K X is equal to 0 for K less than or equal to N. Okay, that's just definition. There aren't The homotopy group starts someplace. For example, the n-sphere itself is n minus 1 connected. Because if you have a map from sk into sn, where k is less than n, you can deform it up to homotopy so that it misses a point. But if you take a point out of sn, the result is contractible. And so you can homotopic to the trivial map. Okay. So this is the, does this board go up? Yeah. This is the Freudenthal suspension theorem. If X is n minus 1 connected, then the suspension homomorphism, which Freudenthal called E for Einhängung, which is the German word for suspension, from pi ks, sig pi k of x to pi k plus 1 of suspension x, is a bijection for k less than 2n minus 1 and a surjection for k equals 2n minus 1. Okay? I have to tell you what suspension is. Okay? And I have to introduce some very, very basic definitions for that. Those are all whiteboards, damn. But they're all white. That's okay? Wait, if you say so. What? Do they have black? Oh, okay. Can't hear you. Fix n, fix x. X is n connected if what I wrote.
Yes, but also the n minus 1
connected as well. For a smaller n, of course it will be, right. Okay. So given two based spaces, x and y, x wedge y denotes the one-point union. You have base points in x and a base point in y. You connect, you identify them. That's the wedge. You know what x cross y is, Cartesian product, and you collapse x wedge y to a point, and that, for reasons I have no idea, is called x smash y, called the smash product. It's the based analog of Cartesian product. It's the right thing to do for based spaces. Here, we think of x wedge y as x cross the base point of y union the base point of x cross y sitting inside the Cartesian product. And that makes sense of the quotient. Okay? Then suspension x is defined to be x smash s1. So the picture is, here's x. Okay? You cross it with a unit interval and identify the base at x cross 0 and the base at x cross 1. But you also have a base point in x right there. And you collapse the line through the base point to a single point. You don't want to have two base points in sight. You don't want to have the upper cone point and the lower cone point. So you connect them by a line. And the quotient map where you start out with the unreduced suspension where you didn't collapse the line to a point and then quotient out that line, that's a homotopy equivalent, so you don't really care. It's just the right definition. Okay? Exercise that Sn smash S1 is homeomorphic to Sn plus 1. Okay? So we use that a lot. And now, the Einhängung there, we look at This is notation for the based homotopy classes of based maps from Sn into x. That's another notation for pi n of x. Okay? So this is given by maps from Sn into x identified up to if they're homotopic. And we want the Einhängung going to Sn plus 1 x smash S1, which is pi n plus 1 of the suspension of x. And what we do is we look at Sn smash S1, and we take our given map, let's call it F, and just smash it with the identity on the circle component to get into x smash S1. That's suspension x, that's Sn plus 1, that's our homomorphism. That's the suspension. Okay? Note, this says that, can't do that. We define pi n stable of x is pi q plus n sigma q x for q large. The point is, these groups become all the same by the suspension theorem if q is large relative to n. Okay? And turns out these stable groups capture far more information than one could imagine. There are all sorts of problems in geometric topology that get translated into problems about stable homotopy groups. So these are things that we would really like to understand and like to be able to compute. Okay. Now, how many of you have seen the notion of a long exact sequence? How many have not? Don't be shy. That's what I asked. They almost all raised their hands, but I want to identify if there's anybody who. It shouldn't be. Don't be embarrassed. If you don't know what a long exact sequence of groups is, tell me. Because otherwise, I won't tell you. All right. So you all know. So the first computational technique in algebraic topology is to construct long exact sequences and compute with them. So we're going to have long exact sequences of homotopy groups, of homology groups, of cohomology groups. You have it. So for that purpose, we need homotopy groups of pairs of spaces. So suppose that I have a pair. That just means that A is a subspace of X, and now we give them a common base point star in A. And we fix the base point. Then we define pi n of X and A to be pi n minus 1 of the space of paths in X that start at the base point and end in A. So an element of this space is a map, omega, say, from the unit interval into X, such that omega of 0 is the base point in A, and omega of 1 is in A. That's what this space is. Okay. I claim, and this might not be obvious, that if A is just the base point, this is just another definition of pi n of x. If A is the base point, this is just pi n of x. I'm going to explain why that's true in case it's not obvious. So What I want to say is, let's let loop X denote the space of based maps from the circle into X. Okay. I can think of S1 as I modulo its boundary. That is, I set 0 and 1 equal to a single point. And then a path like omega, if A is a point, is just an element of loop X. It is just a loop in X. And I claim that we can identify sigma X Y for any space Y with X loop Y. This is obviously when you think about it. What does it mean? You're looking at a map from F from suspension X into Y, and that corresponds to G from X into loop Y. If F of X at time S on the circle is equal to G of X of S, that loop. And that goes backwards and forwards. So given F, I construct G. If a given G, I construct F. And that construction, trivial as it is, preserves homotopies and therefore passes to based homotopy classes of based maps. This is extremely important. It's not hard, but boy, is it ever important. Okay? And using that, we see that if we look at SNX, so this is pi n of X, that's isomorphic to Sn minus 1 loop X, which is pi n minus 1 of loop X. And when you specialize here, taking A equals star, that does tell me that this is two definitions of pi n of X. Okay? So in fact, we could say that inductively, pi n of X is pi naught of loop n X. In other words, all homotopy groups are groups of components, but of a different space. Everybody with me still? Okay. Now, I motivated that definition of homotopy groups of pairs of spaces by saying I wanted to construct long exact sequences. And there is a long exact sequence that looks like this. Oh, I didn't want to erase that. Oh, well. I'm going to explain the proof of this, Freudenthal suspension theorem. Or rather, deduce it from a harder theorem. So I can look at pi n of A. The inclusion from A into X induces a map from pi n of A to pi n of X, right? If I have a map from Sn into A, I compose it with the inclusion and regard it as a map from Sn into X. And then I have a map from here into pi n of xa, because I can think of this as pi n of x comma star, and I have the inclusion of x comma star in x comma a, and that induces that. And then I have a map from pi n minus 1 of a, and then I can keep on going. And this is exact sequence of groups as long as you got of a billion groups, as long as you have a billion groups, and then it's just of groups at the bottom, and then it sets when you get down to finite. There's a long exact sequence like this. This map here is just induced by P1. Take a path here and evaluate it at time 1. That's this map here. Okay. And I'm not going to prove that it's exact, but it is. And now let's come back to the Hopf bundle. So we look at a map S3 into S2. I think of S3 as the unit sphere in pairs of complex numbers. And I think of S1 as the unit sphere in the complex numbers, C. Okay? So S1 is a group. I can multiply element complex numbers of norm 1. I'll get another complex number of norm 1. And if I write S3 modulo S1 for the set of orbits under the group action where I define S1 cross S3 into S3 by sending lambda and a pair consisting of two complex numbers, X1 and X2, to the pair lambda X1, lambda X2. And I identify two elements of S3 if one is obtained from the other by multiplying by an element lambda of the circle. That's called a homogeneous space. It's obtained by passage to orbits. Okay? And S3 modulo S1, if you draw a picture, well, it's not so easy to draw in four dimensions, but you can draw a picture and think about it, and you could see that an element of that orbit is determined by where it intersects the two sphere. So this thing is actually isomorphic, homeomorphic to S2. Okay? So we have P from S3 into S2, namely passage to orbits. Okay? What is the inverse image of a point under this map? It's a copy of the circle, right? This kind of a situation where you have a projection and the inverse image of every point, they all look the same. It's called a fiber. And the thing is locally look. If you take a small neighborhood of S2 and look at the inverse image under P, that just looks like that little neighborhood cross S1. That says it's locally trivial. And you can think about that and see that that's true. Okay. So whenever you have this kind of situation, let's write it more generally. When we have P from E into B with fiber F, that kind of bundle, that kind of local, locally trivial projection, you get a long exact sequence starting with the pair EF, and your condition on this map guarantees that if you choose a base point in F and take the corresponding base point of B, just where F maps to, you get a map to B comma base point. That map, by the properties of this bundle, induces an isomorphism on homotopy groups. So this exact sequence becomes pi n of F to pi n e to pi n b to pi n minus 1 f, and so on. Notice the reindexing. It works. Okay? So in particular, if we apply that to the Hopf bundle here, we get a long exact sequence that looks like pi n of s1 to pi n of s3 to pi n of s2 to pi n minus 1 of s1, and so on. Okay? Now, I'm assuming that you all know that pi 1 of s1 is equal to z. Okay? And I claim that pi q of s1 is equal to 0 for q greater or equal to 2. Why is that? Well, if you look at a circle, its universal cover looks like the real line. And projecting the real line onto the circle, that's an example of a fibration, but now the fibers are discrete. But the real line is contractible, so its homotopy groups are 0. And the higher homotopy groups of a discrete space are trivial, so that's true. So let's see what information we can get from this. First of all, if we look at the case n equals 2, then this is 0. I showed you that, because pi 2 of s3 is 0. And so we conclude that pi 2 of s2 is isomorphic to pi 1 of s1, which is z. But that's neat, because the Freudenthal suspension theorem, which I so stupidly erased, kicks in precisely at that level, so that once you know that pi 2 s2 is z, you know that pi 3 of s3 is z, and pi 4 of s4 is z, and so on. So just by looking at the case n equals 2, we actually have proven that pi n sn is equal to z for n greater or equal to 1. Isn't that nice? Now we look at the case, n equals 3. Now we know that this group is z. And we know that this group is something we want to compute, pi 3 of s2. But this is 0 and that's 0, so we get an isomorphism. Pi 3 of s3 is isomorphic to pi 3 of s2. That gives us our first calculation of a non-trivial homotopy group, pi 3 of s2. And that's Hopf's result of 1930, that the Hopf map has infinite order. That's what Hopf actually proved, that it's not null homotopic, it has infinite order. That was hard in 1930. But you see how easy it is from the Freudenthal suspension theorem. Freudenthal was actually a student of Hopf. And the story goes that Freudenthal came to Hopf one day and said, I want to be a student of yours, and here is my thesis. The easiest student Hopf ever had. Okay? This is way atypical. I just gave you a calculation that took, you know, decades to develop into such a simple form. And there are very few calculations of homotopy groups that are like that. Notice, pi 1 of s1 is the only non-zero homotopy group of the integers, of s1. For every higher sphere, infinitely many of its homotopy groups are non-zero. For pi q of S2, for infinitely many q, that's non-zero. And they're almost all finite. Pi 4n minus 1 of S2n is z plus a finite group. All the rest are finite. And understanding them is just way beyond reach. Okay. Can't hear you.
How are those two long exact sequences?
This one? This, once you grant me that this induces isomorphism from pi star of the pair EF to the pair pi star, to the pi star B star, if you like, which is pi star of B, then this one is a special case of that one, and this one is a special case of that one. Right? I'm just applying it to the pair EF. F is contained in E. Okay, so it's an example of a pair, has a long exact sequence. Okay? Right. Now, I promised to give you an explanation of the Freudenthal suspension theorem. And the explanation is given by something called the homotopy excision theorem. It's due to Blakers and Massey. Massey was my mentor when I was first out of graduate school at Yale. And these papers date from between 1951 and 1953. And it's a, let me see how to state it. Consider a triad X, A, B. That just means that I have A and B are subspaces of X. But they're not subspaces of each other. And we take C equals A intersect B. And just for a slight amount of simplicity, I'm going to assume that all four of these spaces are connected, path connected. You say that X this triad is excisive if X is the union of the interiors of A and B. I believe the terminology is due to Eilenberg and Steenrod in their axiomatization of homology groups, which, depending on time, we may or may not get to in this talk. I'm trying to go as slow as I can. So we're going to consider an excisive triad. And let us, well, I might say that, how do I want to state it? We say that the pair AC is N connected if pi K AC is equal to 0 for K less than or equal to N. Okay? And then the Blakers-Massey excision theorem says, so if X, A, B is excisive, I always misspell this, and A, C is M connected, and BC is N connected. For technical convenience, we break the symmetry and take M greater or equal to 2 and n greater or equal to 1, then pi k a c into pi k of x and b is bijection for k less than m plus n minus 2 and surjection k equal m plus n minus 2. Okay. This is a theorem that nowadays is usually proven using something called the Serre spectral sequence, but the homotopical proof gives you this result, which is sharper than you can get just using the Serre spectral sequence, and it's just Behrens homotopy theory. This was really hard work for Blakers and Massey, and Mike Boardman came up with a much simpler proof, and I simplified that a little bit, and that's inconcise. There's no way I'm going to tell you the details of the proof, but it's not all that hard nowadays. Okay, how is that related to Freudenthal's theorem? Okay. Well, let's come back to the picture. It's the only picture I know how to draw, so let's come back to it. This is the suspension of x, remember? It's not a nice enough picture to be worth color. We break up sigma x as the union of interiors of a positive cone and a negative cone on x. So I take this stuff here is the negative cone, and this stuff here is the positive cone, and then the intersection is just a fattened up ribbon of x. So it's homotopy equivalent to x. I can push it back. So my c over there is just looking like x. So in this case, we can look at we can look at pi k of x, and that's isomorphic to pi k plus 1 of c plus xx. This isomorphism comes from the long exact sequence of the pair, and the cone here is contractible. So its homotopy groups are 0. So the connecting homomorphism in the long exact sequence that goes from there to there is an isomorphism. And then I can go from here to, okay, so here I'm thinking of the excisive triad, suspension x, cone plus x, cone minus x. And so this is an example of the Blakers-Massey homotopy excision theorem, that this is an isomorphism in a range. But this is isomorphic. K plus 1. This, again, by the contractibility of the negative cone and the long exact sequence of a pair. There's Freudenthal's theorem. Okay? That's the deduction of the Freudenthal suspension theorem from the Blakers-Massey theorem, from the homotopy excision theorem. Okay? And I'll just say a tiny bit more and then go on to something totally different. Namely, how do you try to compute homotopy groups? You try to build exact sequences. And there's a non-trivial exact sequence that looks like this. It's called the EHP sequence. And it and its variants are what one uses to study unstable homotopy groups. And since we're not going to be working unstably most of the time, I'm not going to say anything about the proof. We're just going to hint at this is something that comes next. So it's a long exact sequence that looks like pi q of Sn. And now Einhängung goes to pi q plus 1 of Sn plus 1. And this goes by h into pi q plus 1 of S2n plus 1. And this goes by p into pi q minus 1 Sn. And e again into pi q of Sn minus 1, but plus 1. But this sequence is only exact for q less than or equal to 3n minus 2. So the stable range was q less than or equal to 2n minus 1. This is called the metastable range. And it gives you a means of computing in that range. And the numbers look really peculiar the first time you see this. But E is the suspension. H is something called the Hopf invariant. It's a generalization of the invariant that Hopf originally used to show that the Hopf map has infinite order. And we will see lots more about the Hopf invariant later on. This generalization was developed by George Whitehead. P is something called the Whitehead product, which is a very important product in unstable homotopy theory that disappears stably, and that's due to JHC Whitehead. The two Whiteheads are unrelated. Okay. Now for something completely different. Another of those questions. How many people here have not seen categories, functors, and natural transformations? Raise your hands. Really? One person.
How many people are comfortable with categories, functors, and natural transformations? Raise your hand high.
Well, that's impossible because it looks like Chris. Yeah. All right. A category is a two minutes. And the notes are 2 minutes long, too. A category is a collection class of objects, and for each pair of objects, a set of morphisms. Composition is defined when the target of the first morphism is the source of the second. Composition is associative. There is a unit morphism for each object, and it acts as identity morphism, so composing with it doesn't change the morphism you're composing it with. That's it. That's what a category is. The word category, Saunders McLean tells me. What? What? I didn't hear you, luckily.
That explanation was aimed at the sweet spot of uselessness. It was too fast for anyone that didn't know what a category was. And it didn't matter to anyone that did.
For any kind of mathematical object, you define what it means to have a morphism between them. If you've got a morphism from one to another, another to another, you can compose them. That's it. That's all a category is. The word category, according to MacLean, comes from Kant's usage of the word, which in turn comes from Aristotle. And it means very much the same thing in Kant. You have a question? Yes, I can explain natural transformation. Because that's the hardest of them. Eilenberg used to say that Eilenberg and MacLean defined categories in order to be able to define functors. And they defined functors in order to be able to define natural transformations. So. I always obey Agnes. I always obey Agnes. Okay. Suppose we have two functors, F and G, from C into D. So for each object of C, I get an object F of X and another object G of X of D. And for each morphism of C, I get a morphism by applying capital F and capital G to that morphism. So a natural transformation, eta, from F to G, category theorists might use a double arrow, is for each object X of C, a morphism FX into GX of D, such that the diagram FX FF GX eta, F is a morphism from X to Y in C. For every, what? I'm sorry. F, Y, and then we take eta for y, and that goes to gy, and we take eta for x, and that goes to gx, and then we take g of f. For every morphism of C, this diagram of morphisms in D commutes. The intuition is that eta is defined in the same way for every object. So a standard example is there's a natural map from a vector space to its double dual. But there's no natural way to compare a vector space and its dual. Okay. Remember I said that we have a class of objects. So we have the category of topological spaces, category of sets, category of groups, category of abelian groups. The idea for this purpose of categories is to give a language that allows you to compare subjects of mathematics. And algebraic topology is the comparison of topology to algebra. So you have to have a language to express the comparison, and that's what the language was originally developed for. So in any category, we have the notion of an isomorphism. It is a map with an inverse, just that the two composites are the respective identity morphisms. Right? That's just like the usual notion of an isomorphism of groups, but it makes sense for any two objects of any category whatsoever. A natural isomorphism is a natural transformation in which every eta sub x is an isomorphism. Can I hear you? I'm sorry? No. I know of canonical isomorphisms that are not natural. So the word canonical is sort of vague. There is no precise mathematical definition of it, but you know it when you see it. So natural isomorphism is canonical, but not conversely. Not right now, because I got 5 minutes. Where did I start later? Agnes? What? Oh, okay.
Do you have an example that's always an appropriate question?
It is always an appropriate question, and I'm lousy at answering that kind of appropriate question. So ask it to anybody else. Ask it to Dylan. I'm sorry? Yeah, keep asking that question. It's a great question. We're sliding technicalities that have counterexamples under the rug. And we'll keep doing that, because otherwise we'll never get anywhere. Okay. So, categories, functors, we've already explained, natural transformations, right? Here's an example of how you use the language to axiomatize something. Thank you. Look at pi n x. That gives you a functor from the category, I'll call it T, of base topological spaces, with a base point, to sets if n equals 0, sets with a base point, to groups if n equals 1, and to abelian groups if n greater or equal to 2. Okay, so those are examples of functors. And I showed you natural isomorphisms, I'll call it lambda n, from pi n of x to pi n minus 1 of loop x. It's a perfectly good natural isomorphism. Here you have to know that pi n minus 1 loop x is a group, but you know that. And I have lambda 0 pi naught x to set of components, path components of x. Okay? So we think of pi naught x as equal to it because that's how we defined it. But let's just look at this data. Suppose I have some other sequence of functors from t to wherever. Is that a yawn? And suppose we have lambda n prime from pi n prime x into pi n prime omega x and lambda naught primed from pi naught primed of x into this set of components, which I'll write that way to be lazy. So suppose somebody gave me some other sequence of functors and natural isomorphisms like this. Yep, thank you. Somebody's awake. Then I claim that pi n of x must be naturally isomorphic to pi n primed of x. Why? Well, this is isomorphic to pi naught of x, and so is that, naturally, by the given natural isomorphisms. So homotopy groups are axiomatized. What? Oh. Oh, come on. That's better. Welcome. This is Ina Zakharevich, who just arrived. And both Agnes and Ina had flights canceled, so we're lucky to have both of them here, or either of them here. Can't hear you.
What's the absolute state? What's loop n?
Loop n is loop a loop a loop a loop n times. Okay. You can derive the long exact sequence of a pair from this axiomatization. You define the relative homotopy group the way I defined it earlier, and then you use formal theory of vibration sequences and the fact that loop n preserves vibration sequences to derive the long exact sequences. So you can derive properties of pairs from this axiomatization of the absolute homotopy groups. Okay. What we're interested in is the analogous axiomatization of homology. And here there are two axiomatizations that are equivalent. One is just for spaces with base point, like this, and the other is for pairs of spaces. For pairs of spaces, the fundamental axiom is excision. Remember we said that excision implied Freudenthal suspension. So an excision axiom would say, so there's a notion of a homology theory. It consists of functors from pairs of spaces to abelian groups. Pairs of spaces to abelian groups. And there are a bunch of axioms which I'm not going to have time to explain to you, so Ina will explain them this afternoon. Or do you want me to explain them? Okay. But the crucial one is that HQ of AC into HQ of X B is an isomorphism for all Q. This is a map induced by the inclusion starting with an excisive triad. So this axiom turns that hoped for isomorphism that we only had in a range of dimensions for homotopy groups into an isomorphism that holds for all Q. All possible Q. So that's the excision axiom. And there is given a theory on pairs, there is a reduced theory where this, if you're given an unreduced theory, you define H tilde Q is HQ of the pair X and a base point. Here, X is in base spaces, just as we had for homotopy groups, okay? And the claim is that if you have this axiom for this theory, that'll give a suspension axiom for this theory. It says that if you look at H tilde Q of X, there is a suspension isomorphism to H tilde Q plus 1 suspension X in all dimensions now, not just in a range of dimensions. And the proof would be that the excision axiom implies the suspension is exactly the same that I gave in the case of homotopy groups. But now it holds in all dimensions. Okay? So I am hoping, Ina, that Ina will explain the axioms for a reduced homology theory and for a homology theory on pairs, and explain the converse, which says that if you have a homology theory just on spaces, then the suspension axiom, together with other axioms, implies the excision axiom. This is usually proven by a chain-level argument. I haven't mentioned chains. The axiomatization is especially useful here in contrast to homotopy groups because there exist such different constructions of homology that the best way to prove that they give you the same thing is to quote the uniqueness theorem rather than try to compare them directly. So we will see that over the week as time develops. Are there questions?
So don't leave yet. I want to say thank you. One person left.
So this talk and the axioms
is on the website.
Will be on the website.
It is on the
website. Already is.
So you have a question to
you. How did you get it on the website?
Things move quickly. I tweeted your whole talk.
But you didn't tweet this. I have this available.
Okay, let's answer this.
Yeah, I haven't heard it yet. What's the question?
Vibration, loop suspension X, path, and then suspension X, and then story back sequence to show that the transgression map is like Wolfson, and therefore that the map from HQ of X to loop suspension X is like Wolfson, and as a diagram from use. This argument. Because if you assume that the base is two minus one connected, then by a long stack sequence of homotopy groups, you get that the fiber is two minus two connected. So this means that for that E two is equal to zero.
It's going to be the same theorem. It's just that he's thinking about the map X into loop suspension X given by eta of X at time t is X smash t. And one way of studying the Freudenthal suspension theorem is to show that map induces an isomorphism on homotopy groups in a range because the target homotopy groups are one less than the homotopy groups of suspension X. And that's a spectral sequence argument usually, although you can transform the argument I had in mind into an argument about this map. It's the same thing. But believe me, the range is correct. And you can, if you send me an email, and I'll show you in, look at concise. I mean, I've got the numbers. If I screwed the numbers up on the board here, so what? I don't think I did.
What were you saying has a different range
What short exact sweep? I mean.
So Peter can answer your question.
Yeah, I'll answer that privately, because this is not a public question. It's a quibble about a range of dimensions. Which, yeah. Yes?
I have a question about the isomorphisms up there, the pi and x, pi naught. So I think it'll take me a little while to actually work out the maps to the.
Right. The point is, I'm given this. And then I take lambda n minus 1, and that will get me down to pi n minus 2 of loop 2x, and keep on going.
But in more general, the pi naught is a function of x, but pi n.
Ah, excellent question. I'm taking for granted that you know the set of components on loop 2x. Is an abelian group. Why? Because it's the same as the second homotopy group. But there's an actual geometric argument directly that doesn't care about that. Good question. Any other questions? Yes?
I still like to know of an unnatural canonical isomorphism.
Somebody help me, an unnatural canonical isomorphism. Oh, Mark, hi. Mark Behrens back there.
What is the definition of canonical?
We agreed that there is no definition. But we agreed that anything natural is canonical, but not conversely. And now they're asking me to give an example. And I do know examples, but they're not popping into mind. So you could take the category of pairs consisting of a vector space and a chosen basis. Then there is a canonical isomorphism to the dual vector space.
No, I gotta be a little careful. Yeah.
Right? There's a canonical what?
Choice of the fundamental path for k pi n.
There's a difference here. There's canonical choice of an element in some set. That's one thing.
Yeah.
But a canonical comparison that looks something like a functor is something else.
I declare that it doesn't matter.
Yes.
By
the way, we will see that there is a really, really canonical choice of the fundamental class of a k pi n.
And aren't we excited to see it? Let's thank Peter. Okay, I just wanted to continue my rude interruption by telling you more about questions. I've made this beautiful origami box using my sixth grade knowledge of how to build things. And I cut out these pieces of paper. So if you have, I'm going to put this somewhere like here. And during breaks and like a lunch break and so on, you can write questions and put them in that box.
Right.
You need not identify yourself. Isn't that wonderful?
Right. Which reminds me, one of us has to prepare an evaluation sheet. Yeah, we could talk. You just don't let me forget is the point.
Appropriate questions include, what is an example of a widget? Or what is motivation for the theorem?
Well, that's a big question.
But you can put whatever you want in here. And during the problem sessions, or in some way, we will attempt to answer these questions, whether that be during the problem sessions, maybe we'll have to take a moment and go to the board and do something if enough people ask the question, or maybe I'll write a little thing and put it on the website and you can stare at it. But ask questions. There's no reason to sit here and be lost for a week. That would be a waste of your time. We can talk to each other about this anytime. But this is for you guys. So to get the most out of this, write lots of questions.
And come with questions to the problem sessions, and don't be shy. It's okay to show that, hey, this is new to you. That's fine.
Okay,
that's the idea.
Stop and let people have a break.
Yeah. Get out.